We made it here. Isn't that great? Through the swamp of technology, somehow it happened again. It wasn't easy again. It never is. But it's always great to be here. I know that no one's in the mood right now, and so it's hard to really convey too much, because people's minds are cloudy right now, and they can't make decisions. And so I don't want to pressure anyone to make decisions. So I have to be very careful. It's a silent intensive, and we will see how that develops. So don't be under any pressure to feel like you need to understand everything, something, anything, decisions. That'll just get agitated if you feel pressured. It'll lighten up at some point. And then it'll go more smoothly. Right now, it's not going smoothly for hardly anyone, actually. Keep in mind that this summer, coming up, we're February now, right? So February, March, April, May, just 4 more months, it'll be summer. And that'll be the 50th anniversary of the Summer of Love in 1967, the famous Summer of Love. Pretty amazing, huh? So, what a long, strange trip it's been, to say the least. But it's ending well. It's ending well. But the determination and the patience is just, you have to really have that, a lot of that. I asked my friend for the word for the day, and he said, don't talk much. He says people are not in a mood to listen right now, and that's true. They're in this I don't know what to do. And when you don't know what to do, that's panic. You get close to panic, and you don't want anyone being, real clear about what you need to do, because you say, I don't want to do anything. I just want to, paralyzed kind of by not knowing what to do. I feel that way too. I'm not sure what to do. Very difficult, but still am able to make great progress. But that's due to the tremendous foundation I've been able to put in place through a lifetime of effort. Constant effort. It just seems like, how can we keep... Well, actually, it's fun. I look back today, for the first time in a long, long time, I just took a quick look back at some baseball clips on YouTube. Look at Nolan Ryan, bringing back memories of these great pitchers and hitters and stuff that I used to follow baseball just totally. And I came away from it saying, you know what, that doesn't really interest me anymore. What a waste of time. And it's just not as interesting as the spiritual path, which is very, very interesting. Excuse me. And we have to keep working at it. It's rainy here. We're going to have a lot of wet weather for quite some time. In the foreseeable future, really. We don't know what to do in California when we're just wandering around aimlessly, like, what happened? Really don't know what to do with ourselves. Yeah, I'm thinking, what can I do? Because all our lives are built around good weather. So I start working out. Inside, I did a bunch of core work. I did a lot of core work this evening on the BOSU ball, BOSU, BOSU ball. Very helpful. That BOSU ball can be, tremendous workout. Be able to do all sorts of weird stuff. And I'm sure I can learn a lot more. And so it's always great to do a great core workout. You know, it feels great. I did also did 40 push-ups today, 60 yesterday at gas station. So every day, just about, I do that 40 or 60. And trying to let the knee heal and just and keep, you know, eating, you know, real health, really healthy. Just keeping all the good habits going as we head towards the summer of what? What is this summer going to be? That's a pretty interesting question, isn't it? We better start thinking about So the Holy Spirit's giving me a heads up, you know, focus on this summer. Holy Spirit has been absolutely right about the times and the timing of everything was perfect. The two month intensive idea was perfect timing. Got me over the difficult, dangerous spot, so I could get the key insight, the key recognition that I really needed. And now, backing off right at the right time, when people really just don't want to be pressed in any way. You know, they're depressed, and they don't really want to be pressured. So I backed off, and not a lot of people are watching the videos. That's okay. They just they're you know, they're down. They just don't can't quite engage. They don't feel like engaging right now. This is the times where we live in. However, summer is coming. Summer is coming, and it'll be here quicker than we realize, actually. Summer of 2017. What is that going to be like? So we had better start focusing on summer already. Summer of Love, 1967, is the most memorable summer in history, really. It was just nothing like it, and nothing that we expected. It's just. How can you reproduce that? Well, you can't. We will we will approach this summer with full intent to make it, you know, to what? Well, we need to focus on it. It's we don't want to just stumble into it. We want to have some sort of momentum and push. And don't let it slip by. So I was in San Francisco in 1967, Summer of Love. We spent some time up there, driving through, and it was, of course, it was just really. In the air, in the atmosphere, and it was just wow. But it's very different now. It's very different. The demographics were radically different. It was a white middle class. Summer of Love was white middle class, okay, being led by white. Upper class, actually, the trust fund people and the with you know wealthy parents and such were able to fly back and forth and travel back and forth and they could you know could rent houses and you know the people who had money they sort of were the they were able to sort of be the Just like you know, they were the at the top of it really, and they could get on television. And, you know, they just had access to academia. You know, they had connections. They were connected. They were wealthy, but they were still, you know, young people. And you had the whole strata. It was just upheaval. It was upheaval. It was a youth quake. And it was so dramatic that people went through it, that we've never gotten over it, really. It's still resonating, but we may be able to get over it in this summer. It is possible. It is possible. Dharma King Summer. It is possible. As Jesus said in A Course in Miracles, I was reading it tonight, he said in part two, he said, "You're so close now, you can't fail. You're not going to fail, you can't fail." And I realized that hit home with me. It's true. I'm so close now that failure is not even possible. So success, that means success is a certainty. So you may go into this summer kind of all fuzzy. It just, most people are out of it right now. I mean, everywhere I go and everyone I talk with, they're all in a different frame of mind. It's just what it is, and it's a struggle. They're kind of only like half conscious, or like a knockout blow got landed. They're kind of woozy and not really so thinking so clearly or sharp, or not really sure. Hard to pay attention, hard to focus in, hard to feel confident. But the key is to be patient. And just say, "Oh, this will pass. Some cloudy weather, some rainy weather." You have to be really patient. Patience is a great virtue, as is faith. Now, what is faith? Why is faith so important? It's so important for us. We have to use faith in order to succeed. We have to. Because there's a delay between when we make a decision and when we get the results. There's a delay. And if in that delay we panic, that'll block the results. I have a So we must not panic. Now, why is there a delay? And this is very, very crucial to hear this. Is it because of time, space, process, and form? Does that mean it's real? No. Okay, the delay comes from our bias against certainty. We're biased. So it's just our bias at work, slowing the response down. Say, "Oh, I don't want it to come too soon. I don't want it to come too soon." Because we get jittery. Continuity fear, we get jittery. So we're intentionally slowing down our response. It's not because there's some dynamic, a real dynamic like time involved at all, or a process involved. Not at all. Not at all. So we must be clear about this. That's where faith comes in. Faith comes in and says, "Hey, it's because of my bias. I'm biased." That's why repentance is essential. For success is we have to accept that we're biased against certainty, severely biased. And continuity fear is holding this bias in place because we're biased towards what we're familiar with. Okay, so as we change our expectations to something we're not familiar with, this bias kicks in and slows down the response. So the answer's already here. It's just that we're delaying it because of our bias. Or refusing to accept it, or slow in acceptance. So when I set the world free, I'm waiting for the light to come, and it did today in a very gentle way of some mental imagery. The Dharma tree, I call it. It was fantastic. We're on this mountain road. I'm on this mountain road, and the road's falling apart. It's sliding down the mountainside. Very steep mountain. It's the ground's so saturated, the road is starting to give way. There's landslides all over the place, mudslides, and this road's in big trouble. So a lane is closed, and we have to wait to go up it slowly, and we had to stop for quite a long time. So I was just we were just all the traffic just stopped, and so I said, "What do I do?" And I said, "Let me start visualizing something." So it came upon me to start visualizing, and it came to me what to visualize this huge palm tree. I call it the Dharma tree. Massive, in fact, it's so big, it's fronds, palm fronds, like an umbrella, cover all visible landscape that I see. And it travels with me. Wherever I go, it's there. It's this massive palm tree, but it's so beautiful. It's the Dharma tree, the wish-fulfilling tree. And I began to visualize all these qualities that were so sublime about it. It's just so beautiful. And I visualize it right there at a clearing in the redwood forest, this massive palm tree rising above all the redwood trees with this gigantic canopy that holds us in its shade, this wonderful, beautiful shade, shading us from the world, shading us from turmoil. And I'm just dwelling under this Dharma tree that goes with me wherever I go. And it has its own atmosphere. See, the light there is free, so it's not pretending to cast doubt upon me at all. So it has its own atmosphere. It's not the atmosphere of the world. It's the atmosphere of the Dharma tree. And I'm imagining, I'm experiencing this atmosphere. It has its own sound and music and fragrance and beauty, all of that. And so I'm just sitting underneath this massive, beautiful Dharma tree. The Dharma tree. So I did that. I visualized that for about 15 minutes or so, and then it stayed with me most of the day. I said, okay, it's very gentle, very subtle, but at least it's something, right? The light is responding. I never had experienced anything like this before. And it all is clear to me. I mean, I can see why, but it's not possible to really explain this to those who don't have the foundation and the momentum and aren't really motivated, aren't clear-minded, and everything has to be right. And it's just not there right now, because everybody is really just shaking their heads, saying, you know, wow, what kind of future do we have really? Right, they're worried about that. Well, when you set the world free, you don't worry about a future. See, this is so you have to get to this point of setting the world free from me. This is not talked about enough in the world at all. Jesus talks about in A Course in Miracles, it's all about that, actually. It really is, but this doesn't get emphasized. So the emphasis just isn't there. So the training, the background, all of this, it just isn't there in the world. It's just not there. So I can't really get this, you know, through to anyone really. But you just have to keep heading in that direction. Everyone has to keep heading in this direction. And eventually it'll just click, and you'll just suddenly, oh yeah, wow. Eventually. But in the meantime, well, that's the question, isn't it? It seems like there's a struggle. It's just too much. You know, it really is. It really is. And people will take refuge, you know, they'll start taking refuge in various places, hoping that that'd be good enough. But the Dharma tree is my refuge here, at least for now. But it's inexplicable to those who don't have the right background, who have not changed their expectations in a certain way. It's simply inexplicable. It seems like a miracle. They just won't be able to explain it. But for me, it's easy to understand. I don't have a problem with that at all. But there's this gap. There's definitely a gap. There really is a gap, and I understand that. If you don't have it, it just will seem too amazing to understand. It just will flounder in words, and we don't want that. We don't want anyone to flounder in words. So at some point, there's this distinction between a teacher and a student. And I tried to blur that boundary because I tried to be like a student teacher in this world to try and help bridge this gap of awe that people have towards teachers. I say this, it's not right. You shouldn't have awe. But it hasn't worked. Being a student teacher has not worked at all. Unfortunately, but I can see, why it's too tempting to the dynamics are such that it doesn't work right. It doesn't work. So the only thing to do is to be a teacher and forego the student teacher situation. It doesn't really work. So when you're a teacher, there's a clear delineation between the teacher and the student, and because the student just doesn't understand how it's possible, what just seems inexplicable. What the teacher's about, it just seems inexplicable. But the teacher understands. It's easy. So then you have this kind of distancing awe sort of thing, and that's what's been going on throughout history. And I tried to change that, but it didn't work. It didn't work. So I have to back away for a little while and get to be a teacher. So that can help out. I don't like the inexplicableness of it, it's but that can't be solved by just being ignorant of it myself. I say, well, I'm a student teacher, I don't really understand it. And then people think they can relate with me better. Say, yeah, you're one of us. You can't understand either. And I say, yeah, but I kind of understand it. And we said, well, understanding is too difficult. Why don't you just, help us feel good about our lack of understanding? So you get caught in the middle as a student teacher. You get caught in the middle, actually. It's not good. So in order to understand, a lot of background work has to be done. You have to change your premise, your basic premises, and your expectations. All of that has to be changed. So it takes a lot of work, a lot of work. And what happens is they look at the student teacher and says, "Hey, why don't we just say call it good? You're good enough, and we feel comfortable, more comfortable with you, because you don't have this inexplicableness about you." The Dharma tree is not there, and so we'll just call that good. And I have to say no, because I don't feel right, and we haven't really got the answer at all yet. So people want to get out of the work because they want to be happy now, and it doesn't happen that way because we're so biased. So unfortunately, we have a severe bias against certainty. We're very used familiar with doubt. And so we try to bring doubt into everything we do. So that's why we feel it's inexplicable, because we doubt that it's possible. But you can't have your cake and eat it too. You as long as you're bringing doubt into it, it'll be inexplicable. In other words, I doubt that can happen that way. I doubt I can set the world free. So that can't be it. I doubt that's it. And so then you can't have certainty, and then, so then it just seems inexplicable. I mean, how could you have this effect and still have doubt? And then it becomes very perplexing. And the answer is there is no doubt. But we say, well, there has to be some doubt. If you don't work at it, doubt will continue. But you have to work at it and evaporate your continuity fear. There's no way around it. There's no way around the issue of familiarity. There just isn't. So, that's how it is. There's no way around it. Except just, you got to plod along and do the work and just really not give up and just stay steady. Determination is the key. Realizing is you have a severe bias against certainty that's blocking your recognition of how easy it is, how simple it is. You just give up the effort to cast doubt upon God. That's all. Just set the light free from that foolish mission. And then the light will now reflect back to us. Certainty instead of doubt. The world is just a reflect light presenting doubt trying to us. So evidence of doubt, manufactured evidence, is all fake, but it's an excuse to doubt, to seem that we can doubt ourselves. It just makes us believe we can doubt ourselves. That's all it is. And it's just light. And you see all this and you recognize it finally and you just say, oh, yeah, of course that's it. That's obviously what's going on. But before you see it, it's not obvious at all because you doubt it. Right? So as long as we're trying to be happy with doubt, we won't make the key recognitions. We have to realize we'll never be happy with doubt. It's not possible. And just keep emphasizing this, keep emphasizing. A Course in Miracles is really great. It really is great. But it has to be like your life in so far as you really feel, that it's there for you. It's there for you. It's not about A Course in Miracles community. It's not about A Course in Miracles groups. It's not about A Course in Miracles seminars. It's not about A Course in Miracles retreats. It's not about A Course in Miracles cruises. It's not about any of that, actually. It's about you and A Course in Miracles. Just directly going to it, direct access, directly going to it. And it's for you. It's for you. It's there for you. That's how I've always taken it. I always took it. It's The Course in Miracles is here for me. That's what it's here for. This is the attitude I've always had. So you can just do it as self-study. You don't need to go through someone else. You just turn directly to it. It's there for you. It's all there. The clarifications are there. And so don't wait for somebody to explain it to you so much. You have to work at it yourself and stumble along and make your way through it. And go beyond the words to using faith that you know God is going to respond and give you another world that is, you know, that reflects certitude, light reflecting, a world that reflects certitude to you. No doubt about what you are. And have the attitude of faith that it's a done deal. It's not if, it's when. You know, how long will your bias delay it? But it's already a done deal. There's no doubt about it. And have this type of confidence that only faith can bring. And so building up this faith is really difficult. So you have to build up your faith so that you can actually take this position like I take is you know, it's success is guaranteed, and I literally prepare myself for the wow of it. I'm saying, wow. So I act as if it's already here, and I say, wow, this is more than I ever imagined. This is way better than I could ever imagine. So it's very shocking. You know, it's just so wonderful. So I just imagine, not anything specific, how wonderful it is, but I just imagine that I'm overwhelmed by how wonderful something is. So wonderful, it's overwhelming, and I have to wow it. So I practice that way, as if this is going to happen. So I prepare for it. I prepare. And this is really what works. But you have to build your faith up in Jesus, in the Dharma Kings, and what they're saying. I really trust in what he says and what the Dharma Kings say. You know, it's gospel for me. So I say, I know I'm going to get it. So I have to prepare for its arrival. And when I'm ready for it to arrive, it will arrive. No doubt, I have no doubt about that. So I just have to keep preparing. If it hasn't arrived, it's because I haven't prepared enough yet. That's all there is to it. And it's quite interesting to see how your mind gets off track, how it delays, how it just, you know, you have to keep bringing it back, bringing it back, bringing it back to what's important. How the wow is so important because the mind starts spinning all these, shock-driven storylines and speculations, and you have to just bring it right back to the wow. Down, wow, it's here. Just act like it's here. Wow. So the light, the light that is reflecting now our freedom and certainty of our freedom, is here. It's already here. So I'm wowing it. I'm not thinking about when does it get here. No, it's already here. That's called using faith to help you practice. That's called skillful means. That's the Dharma. Skillful means. Very skillful means. Faith is very skillful means. And right now in the world, what's happened is faith has taken a big hit in the world. People are doubting their faith right now, so they can't practice in this way. This is the trouble right now. It's sort of a double bind. In order to succeed, you have to practice this way, but right now the times are such that people just can't practice in this way. So that, of course, they're going to feel like, well, I can't succeed then. You know, then that just sorts of negative feedback loop. So, you know, what to do about this? Because the problem is faith is towards salvation and not anything else. It should not never be employed in worldly stuff. But people use faith in a worldly way, and they got, you know, they're getting burned by it. They'll continue to get burned by it in every which way. That's not the right use of faith at all. They're looking for like political results. They're looking for this kind of result, you know, happiness with doubt. That'll never happen. Faith always has to do with God and what God, saying that God will do this for us. There's no doubt about it. I have no doubt about it. Just my bias puts up this delay mechanism. That's it. That's all there is to it. Nothing else to it. It's already done. It's already done it. for us, actually. Already done it for us. It's just we have to drop our delay. And have faith in that. So what's missing right now is faith. And so if you don't have faith, all the explanations in the world aren't going to do, won't do any good. They will not do any good. So in a world that lacks faith, you can't really teach. You cannot really teach. You have to have faith. You have to repent and have faith. There's no other way. Repent means to recognize you have a very severe bias against certainty, and you have to work on this bias. And then faith is a skillful means of working on this bias in an effective way. You know you're going to succeed, because Jesus has told us. God told us you will succeed. You practice this way. You go this way. You can't lose. You can't miss. So it's this super confidence. It's confidence in that God, there's no doubt in God. There's no doubt in what we are. All doubt is just a wishful thinking. It's not, none of it is true. So I've always had tremendous faith, but this world has really put it to the test. It seems to constantly be trying to diminish your faith and misplace your faith onto social solutions, political, social, economic, medical, you name it, all these solutions. Don't place your faith in any of that. Place your faith that in what God has for us, which really what the light has for us when we set it free from pretending a world of doubt for me, then the light will present another world. Present a world, and Jesus said, "This is the final world. Though this is permanent in terms of, as long as you need perception, it'll be stay with you. This world reflects certainty to us, safety, certainty. It reflects what we really are, instead of trying to doubt what we really are." The light, we set the light free, and so then it reflects the fact of freedom to us. This is how it works. But we have to have faith that to bridge the bias gap, the delay that bias causes, we have to bridge that with faith and not with more explanations. Once you get it clear, then you've got it. And now you just have to be patient and wait for this bridge, to bridge the gap of our bias. You have to be patient, positively patient, not depressedly patient, not depressed. Depression isn't patience. Depression means you've lost your patience. So, like today, I was sort of vacillating between depression and faith or patience, and I went sort of. But I keep going back to patience, right? So I've worked my way, largely out of the depression reaction. I used to be very depressed because I lost my faith to a large extent. The world simply told me that I was crazy, that I had to adapt to the world, that it's real. And I said, no. What I'm seeing with the mind's vision is more real than the world. And they said, well, you just your imagination. The world is real, and what you're seeing is your imagination. Well, it's just the other way around. The world is our imagination. And what I was seeing is that the freedom of light, that's real. So the world has it backwards. And so, but this got pressured on me so severely that faith became difficult. And then so I got depressed. And now I'm coming back into the faith, back when I was able to see a world where light was not bound by any imaginary limitations of time, space, process, and form. The self-luminous light was not some sort of reflective light off of things. And it reflected certainty to me. I was very certain when I was young. And people kept testing my certainty. They were very perplexed by it. Very perplexed. They'd ask me questions. I said, "Why are you asking me questions? What's the problem?" It's just doubt. What are you doubting? I don't get it. Well, we kind of doubt, how many, what's going to happen? This, and I said, "Well, what do you mean that this is going to happen?" Or what's the? So they did a bunch of, psychic tests on me and all this stuff. And I was just like, "Oh, what are you doing? It's so stupid." You know that. And they said, "Well, you have psychic abilities." I said, "No. I just have certainty. The certainty of the self. The certainty that light does exactly what we ask it to do. So I trusted in the light." And the world kept saying, no, this world is real. And what you're experiencing, this freedom of light, that's just your imagination. You're making it up. That's so it's this crazy, huh? Upside down and backwards. And yet it's the pressure is on all of us. So when I was younger, then I was just experiencing the light as reflecting certainty to me. So now I'm getting back to that, and I'm having like episodes that of feeling like I did when I was young with my imagination, supposedly my imagination, but actually the light dawning upon me in the way of reflecting certainty to me. Gentle glory, so beautiful, so sublime. And it may seem like I'm using my imagination, but that's just part of faith too. It's helping bridge the bias gap. But the light is really there. It's really there. But this recognition, it can escape us. I can understand how it can escape us. It certainly had escaped me for a long time. But when you get it, then that changes everything. Changes the equation. So a changed equation makes it easy. Makes it easy. Without that, a changed equation, it just seems so difficult and perplexing, and yet we think that somehow we have to figure it out, and then that causes us to really freak out. So silent intensive is helpful because it doesn't put any the pressure on anybody to figure it out. They could realize, hey, there's something very sublime here. And I'm not quite able to explain it. I don't quite get it. I don't really have to try and figure it out. Takes the pressure off of us. You can't figure it out. You have to have some key recognitions, and then you just see, oh, that's just it changes the equation entirely. It's a different equation. So I was trying to figure out the wrong equation. It didn't add up. I was trying to, it doesn't add up. I'm trying to figure out why doesn't it add up. It doesn't add up because we have the wrong premises and haven't quite gotten to the world as what it really is. We keep trying to avoid that. It seems scary. Our continuity fear is very scared of recognizing what the world is just what it really is. It's just a pretense of our imagination trying to cast, give evidence of doubt, cast doubt upon ourselves. That's, and by extension, cast doubt upon God. That's all it is. That's what all the world is. We cast doubt upon ourselves, try to, using bodies. So the key recognitions will elude us because of continuity fear, and maybe for a long time. Unfortunately, I don't see any way around it. That's why, for me, I always just kept working at it. I said, you know, it's unlikely to just magically resolve. You know, I'd like it to, but it just doesn't seem like that's going to happen. And it hasn't happened. It hasn't happened. It's all just been because of the work I've done. Of just steady determination and evaporating continuity fear. That's the only reason I've gotten to where I'm at. It's the only reason. It's just familiarity. You know, you have to work at it long enough so familiarity starts setting in. And then you gain confidence in familiarity, you see. But without doing that, you just can't, you're not going to be able to make it. I mean, I don't see how it's possible. So that's why for instance, Tibetan Buddhism, they give these intensives 1 year, you know, they keep, as you get older, they make them longer and longer, is they realize that until you actually recognize that familiarity really is setting in and it's helping you, you say, oh my gosh, this I can work on familiarity and it's all important. You start seeing the results from getting familiar with something. Until you see that, if you don't see that, experience it, you're just not going to make it. So that's why you have intensives, is you do it long enough so that familiarity starts kicking in and you see the benefits of it and you say, holy cow, this familiarity really is the key. And so then you become motivated to keep working at it. But so there's this gap. There's this gap. And you have to work at it long enough until you have some hindsight to see that familiarity is the key. And you've just simply gotten familiar enough so that you're now comfortable to look at it and your expectations look at it in a different way. Then you understand the role that familiarity plays. Without that, you're just floundering. So that's why Tibetan Buddhism sets things up for intensives. And some of them are, you know, 3 years or a long time. But that, what does that do? That's very helpful. At the end of it, you have the hindsight and you say, hey, I feel different. Why? Well, I've gotten familiar with so much stuff that I wasn't familiar with before, and I changed my expectations so much. So it's you know, familiarity and change expectations, which evaporate continuity fear. And then what you thought was so difficult, now you feel like, no, I changed the equation, it's easy. I don't have familiarity as a problem anymore with that, and that changes everything. It becomes easy. So until we get that experience of easement because of a prolonged work at it, with familiarity, we just don't have the leverage we need. We don't have the faith, don't have the leverage. You need the leverage on the path. You have to get it, leverage. So again, through historically, they would put people through, you know, monastic training so that they would get the leverage. You know, one way or another, you have to do this, get leverage. For me, I've just been studying, you know, the teachings of the Dharma Kings, especially A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words, and then Longchenpa and Rama Maharshi and Ananda Maima, and, you know, the various teachings. I've been continuously studying, contemplating, like a you know, real long intensive, and then having hindsight about how much progress I've made. I've been able to see that it's intellectually, it was always there, but it didn't work. I couldn't really use faith properly. I didn't have the leverage. But with familiarity then, I suddenly say, hey, I've got the leverage. It's like working out. One day you realize, hey, I can do this. I did some push-ups on the floor recently, 5 of them. I want to keep doing more of them. Whereas before I couldn't do any. But now my core is so strong, I'm able to, I'm able to handle the whole thing. You got to be very fit to do push-ups, perfectly, all on the floor. Just you have to be very fit. And it helps if you're light too. Your kids can do them because they weigh like 90 pounds or something. But as adults, as you get older, the push-ups become very difficult. But I'm able to do them now, and it's just it's core strength, it's shoulder strength, it's all the work I've done, and getting familiar with the changes. And then one day I felt, you know what? Maybe I can do this. I tried it. Oh my gosh, I can do it. So, working out steadily, steadily, steadily. It's been now, almost, going on a year and a half. I've really, well, working out. I didn't start until, so it's like a year and 4 months or something. But I've really been working out for more than a year, steady. And so hindsight, I can apply it now, and I can see, oh, I'm much. Much better shape than I was before. I'm a different place now. This is what works. Intensives are what work on the spiritual path. That's what works. That's why Jesus commissioned A Course in Miracles. The way he set it up was for the workbook to spend 1 year on it, which I did back in, I don't know when it was. Maybe it was the 70s or the 80s, early 80s. I did the workbook for 1 year. But I didn't do a very good job. I did a lousy job, actually. It was just too difficult. I didn't know what he was talking about. I just could not. I didn't have enough faith, but I did it. And he set it up that way. To, it's a 1 year intensive, the workbook, 365 lessons. And yeah, I did it every single day. I said, okay, here's a lesson. But I was just going through the motions. As it went on, I was overwhelmed by how difficult it was. It really is. I know, it's so advanced, it's so intense, it's so amazing. I just had to cut myself some slack. Said, wow, that was difficult. I it was a little too difficult for me, but I did it. And that's an intensive. That's an intensive. That's how Jesus set it up. And this is how the spiritual path has to be set up. You have to get that leverage of really recognizing that working on familiarity does work. You see, if you just constantly piecemealing it occasionally, you never are able to recognize the familiarity for the problem that it is, and that you're able to actually evaporate it relatively, pretty quickly. Quickly enough to have faith that you're going to be able to succeed. You just don't. You're just kind of spinning your wheels. So intensives are really important. But nobody's really in the mood for those right now. But you can't just piecemeal it and not just occasionally work on it. It doesn't provide enough momentum. Again, we're severely biased against certainty. We're very familiar with doubt, and we keep going back to that familiarity with doubt. But if we really spend every day getting familiar with truth and certainty, and we do it for a long enough time period, we begin to recognize, hey, it's familiarity really is the problem. Continuity fear is the problem. The lack of familiarity with truth, we really are biased, but we can resolve this bias through familiarity, getting familiar. That's how we resolve it. And you might wonder, how come Tibetan Buddhism, for instance, they meditate for 40 years and they finally they get it. It's a lifetime thing. And we say, ah, it's too difficult. You know, I can't do that. Well, it's what works. It's what works. So the spiritual path, it needs to be a lifetime thing. Absolutely, it does. The evidence of history is that anything other than that doesn't work. It doesn't work. Because you have to, it's familiarity is the problem. And continuity fear of like going back to being, to doubt. That's what we're familiar with. Very familiar with that. And we'll just keep going back to it. And then in doubt, we will try to arrange some sort of compromise of, well, some of this truth is true, but some isn't true. So try to satisfy both doubt and certainty. And that's all that is just doubt, more doubt. In other words, we're doubting certainty. Certainty isn't some certainty and then some uncertainty. That's doubt. Certainty means there's no doubt at all. Had a good post-workout drink. It was tart red cherry juice, 2 scoops of chocolate whey protein powder, and a coconut water sports drink, blueberry flavored, I believe, and then a bunch of frozen blueberries. And I put that together. Wow, was that was terrific. Now, working on the core, fitness-wise, is quite difficult. I mean, I avoided it for a long time. It's not a glamour thing, it isn't. It's glamour thing is working on, the biceps. It's easy, just a bunch of curls, a bunch of weights, stuff that shows muscle, and that's what most people do. But really working on the core, or some people work on just the abs because it shows up and they can, it looks great. But really working on the core, that's not, it's not glamour. It's not glamorous. And this was really difficult. It's really difficult to get to it. And it's still kind of difficult. I'm still not sure, like, what exercise I really need to do. But I keep, twisting and doing all sorts of stuff that puts tension on the core, and I just keep working the core just steadily, patiently, just feeling, it's going to pay off. It'll pay off. One thing that helps is my back. I have had back problems throughout my life, and this core work is helping my back. Really, it is tremendously. And I just say, like, wow, why didn't I get to that earlier? Well, when you're young, you just think you shouldn't have to do so much work. You should be able to get it quickly, and you don't really work at it enough. I don't know. It's just stupid. It's hard to realize why are we so stupid, in life, but we are. So I just keep grinding away. It's like, so the spiritual path needs to be like the core stuff. You get to the core, you're doing core exercises. You need to do the practices that really will really work. And not the glamour stuff. And using faith is a core practice. It's so powerful. It's what really works. I have faith in this. That this is what really will work. It will work. So for me, the light is coming. The light of that reflects certainty is coming. The gentle glory is coming. Light and it's coming, and I will experience it. And it's going to be, just. I have to prepare for it in my mind and my reactions. It's going to be very wowish. So I just sit quietly in gratitude and also in wow, like wow, I just need to be really I practice it as if it's already arrived and that it's hit me so strong that I'm in this shock. So this is faith-based practice. Practice like it's a total fait accompli. It's for sure it's going to come. There's no 100, it's 100% for sure. Practice that way. Not so easy, huh? Doubts start kicking in. But I'm able to practice that way now. Somewhat, right? I mean, doubts, there's the jitters are still there. You have to keep bringing the mind back patiently and be patient. I mean, just like I'm able to practice the core work physically now. I'm able to do core work, and it's like I could do all sorts of exercises I couldn't do before. I'm able to do it. I have like the base core strength now that I'm able to do all sorts of exercises and stuff. And I'm able to, it's like, wow, I'm able to do that. It's like when I was young. Physically, the fitness I have is like when I was young. And you work at the core from all sorts of different angles. It's not just one exercise. That's not really core work. Core work is really coming at it from 360 degrees. That's what it really is about. So it's not about just doing crunches, okay? That's ab work. That's not quote unquote real core work. Real core work is a consortium of all sorts of different exercises that work your core from all different directions and different modalities. And that's what really builds up the core. And I keep inventing new ones all the time. You know, that's what you need to do is you need to keep doing variations and coming up and keep it interesting. Yeah, we don't want to just do crunches every day. That's what we did when we were young. We weren't trained properly. You just do just you know just do sit-ups. So I was like a sit-up champion. I set all sorts of records in speed. You know, how many can you do in, you know, this amount of time, in 1 minute, in 5 minutes, all this kind of stuff. I was like, boom, 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 like that. But was that really core strength? Not really. Not really. So it's interesting that it was too one-sided. It wasn't 360 degree. And, I wasn't able to sustain my faith in the world because for some reason it wasn't full enough. Just like my exercise wasn't full enough when I was young. But now, you know, I still do some sit-ups but it's different. I don't really do just conventional sit-ups. I do so all sorts of other stuff that make it different and more difficult and a different angle. It's just much more complete. And that's the right way to do core work. And it's a challenge, you know, because they have to keep coming up with different stuff. But doing all those sit-ups, I still had back problems. It just so I had spiritual problems too, that I was strong, but I wasn't strong enough. I was agile and quick and strong, but not overall balanced enough to employ faith the way it has to be employed. The skillful means that need to be used, I wasn't quite able to do it. because of not being able to use faith quite strongly enough. Wasn't balanced enough. Didn't quite have it. Now I have it. I have it. I also have, you know, much stronger back. And I really work at it. I mean, I really do. As far as just all sorts of exercises, it just I do put a lot of strain on my back on my exercise. I use that foam roller on my back and roll on it with my back, especially on my tailbone and hip bones, and it puts tremendous strain on the back. And I feel it. I mean, when I go to sleep, that it aches. You know, it aches during the next day. It's achy. I don't feel so great. So I'm really paying a price to strengthen it. But it's like a price I feel like I have to pay. The same thing with spiritual path. You pay a price for all your efforts. It stresses you out. But you have to get to that faith, using faith in the right way. It's a done deal. So I'm just waiting for what's for certain going to be delivered. It's like you're waiting for a package from FedEx, and you know it's arriving, so you just start, you put yourself in the mood that it's already arrived. And, wow, the Ferrari's already in the driveway, that kind of thing. And use your mind right with faith to believe it's there. Really believe it. And so that way you begin to experience the reactions to it and can get used to the reactions to it. And once you do that enough, then it will arrive because your reactions will have been toned down enough so it's not overwhelming for you. So that your bias doesn't, you know, kick in and you lose it. So you may very well be much better when you're 60 than when you were 16. Okay. The overconfidence of youth, thinking, I can get by on not trying to do too much, causes downfall. But if you keep working at it and determine that this lifetime I have to do it, I'll just keep working at it, then when you're 60, you may be really dialed in. You have to look at it like that. You have to look at that you're going to have a life, and you want this life to succeed. You really want to succeed with this lifetime. And so, you know, you're going to reach 60 at some point, right? You're going to be older, and so you have to make sure that you're dialed in, you know, when you reach that age. Otherwise, then you go downhill. You go downhill. There's a tendency to go downhill. But for me, it's the opposite. I'm better than ever, actually. Better than I was even when I was young, actually. Yeah. Similarity. I was good when I was young, but I'm better now. I'm better in terms of just overall. Everything. Just the effort, the sheer effort of getting familiar, building in faith, using the practices of faith, all of that. You know, I've proven to myself it works. And so you gain even more faith. The more you prove it to yourself it works, the more faith you get. And then the more you use it, and the more effective it becomes, and the more, so it's a positive reinforcement. So I have that, one of those things, those rollers, a wheel with two handles on either side, that you put your knees on the floor, and you put this thing on the floor, and then you roll it out. You know, it really stretches your abs and back. That's very difficult. I stretch it almost all the way out. I'm almost flat, and then pull myself back up. It puts tremendous strain on the back. But, you know, I do that most days. You know, and I do the push-ups almost every day. And I do this stuff, and I just keep doing it. Right? You just keep doing it every day, almost every day. Sometimes you might miss a day or two, but always get back to it. Just keep doing it. Same thing with faith. I keep doing this faith-based practice. Just keep doing it. And I just get stronger and stronger and stronger at it. And this is the benefit of age. That's why elders have been respected throughout history. And we need to bring that back. That's what's lacking in the world right now, and that and wise elders are also lacking. Because we devalued it so much. We really demonized it so much in the last four generations. But if you go at it properly, then when you get older, let's say 60 on, last, say, 30 years of your life, if you should choose to age, which you don't really have to, actually, but the last 30 years, you may just be, you know, super. You may, the light will come to you. The light that you set free now is free to reflect that freedom to you. And what you experience is a different, a transformed world. As Jesus says, you'll still see bodies to comfort and to heal and out of compassion, etc., but for no other reason. But the world you see will be a world of just absolute loveliness, gentle glory. And you'll have the wisdom at that point. So that's why historically we've respected our elders. The young people respected the elders because it is possible to get that leverage and have use faith properly, and then be liberated really from delusion, be a presence, spiritual presence in the world, and then explain to the younger people, this is what you, is possible for you, and this is what you, this is, you should set yourself with good habits going forward, and just stick with it, and don't give up. We just have this, such a youth culture right now, we've lost our way. It's way overemphasized, the youth culture now. It turns people into, well, we know what's happened. Boy, it used to be that people would go to the elders with so much respect to listen. Not to badger them, not to compete with them. They just say, "Elder, you know, I am asking for your help. And to find my way in life. I know it's so difficult. I face such a difficult path. And I know that you have found great wisdom through hindsight and working with familiarity and all that. So I'm here to listen to whatever you have to say to me and take it to heart." That's the attitude that people, younger people used to have. And that's what makes successful civilization, actually. We have the makings of an unsuccessful civilization on this road right now. A catastrophic failure. Lack of respect for the elders. And because youth, it fools us, doesn't it? We think we almost have it, but we never quite get it, right? We almost have it. That's youth. And we think, well, I don't have to do too much. I almost got it. It never works out for us, does it? It's very tricky, youth. We get tricked by it. We say, well, I can delay a day because I can get it tomorrow. That's a youth. But as you get it, as you keep doing that, it becomes a habit. And then you start getting familiar with not having it, right? And doubt, you start getting more and more familiar with doubt one day at a time. And before you know it, you're in big trouble. So you cannot go about it that way. The way that youth goes about it is not the right way. You have to learn another way to go about it. So you have to graduate from that sort of teenage attitude of it's a youthful attitude, but it sort of starts to get bad when in the teenage years. we're so distracted as a culture right now. There's so many distractions. In simpler civilizations, you know, it's easy to go to the elders. There's not much to do. So you go to the elders and ask them and listen to them. There's no television to go to. You go to the elders and they tell you stories. They tell you about their life. They tell you, pass on the wisdom. Pass on the wisdom. Wisdom culture. We have a TV culture now. We don't have a wisdom culture anymore. It's a disaster. So I'm trying to pass on what I have discovered, but you know, there's not a lot of interest, which is, you know, shocking, because I have a lot of hindsight, because I've worked so diligently at it constantly, that now I just have a wealth of hindsight and a wealth of recognizing, you know, the leverage, how to use it, where you find it, what it is, how you use it. But we don't have a mentoring culture anymore. It used to be the elders mentored the younger people. Now just younger people just kind of mentor themselves with, you know, smartphones. And they said, we don't need the elders for anything. Yeah, it's a disaster. And my generation might be the last great generation where we did listen to our elders, actually. And we're very different. You know, people my age now, I meet a lot of them, and I say, wow. We didn't know how good we had it. We didn't realize that, you know, how bad things would get. And we're noticeably different. It's like talking with them. It's so easy. It's just like we still have these values and we can relate. And we realize we're pretty doggone good, you know, comparatively, you know, wow. Because I paid attention to my elders, of course. Asked questions. Listen. Now, I could tell that most of them were mistaken, but I still respected, you know, that had respect for those who have come before and the wisdom that has been passed down throughout the ages here. And paid great attention to it all. So you may think, wow, maybe he's just sitting there tired. No, I'm just waiting patiently for the light to dawn upon me, the experience of the light to dawn. That's, I'm just waiting patiently with faith. That's all. So you can work out, be strong, and still do this. You know, I recommend a combination of physical activity, exercise, etc., and then this patient waiting, using faith. So I had a great workout earlier. Now I'm just employing this faithfulness here. Calm faithfulness. That's what Jesus advised. He said, just go beyond words and just sit patiently and expect it. With expectation that it will arrive. With certitude, as much certitude as you can, much faith, much expectation. It's arriving. Even as we speak, it's arriving, that kind of attitude. With gratitude, an attitude with gratitude. This is what Jesus advises. He says, you know, you're ready for it. So just do that. So, yeah. But But most people simply don't understand this at all. They just don't. But some do, right? So if you understand it, you just have to accept it, that you're one of those who understand it. And then just go with that. You have to go with that. If you understand it, you get it, then just do it. There's nothing else to say. Just do it. Somehow, you know, you have the right stuff. And don't think about it. Why too much? You know, you have the right stuff. That's how it is. You've done the work. So now you use faith. The powerful techniques that really bring the path to an end for you. It's a successful conclusion. Well, it's getting pretty late now. It's like 12:15 in the morning. But you know, I'm just waiting, patiently waiting, with positive expectation, and I keep applying faith to it, like to make it feel like it's here. It's dawning, like I'm experiencing the dawn of it. Wow. See, with this technique, you don't need words. You say, it's dawning. Wow. You just feel that and believe it and feel it. And then just feel just wow it. Just wow it. Something truly marvelous has arrived. You feel that way. Believe it. And it's going to be, it's permanent. This is permanent. Put that in there. This is permanent. This is core work. This is core work. That's the real work. The ones who are wise, they do this core work. It's just really gets stronger and stronger and stronger the more you do this. The core work doesn't show up so much. You just wear baggy clothes and nobody can tell that you have a strong core. Whereas if you've done all these, you know, upper body muscle stuff, you might be able to tell, you know, you've got some strong, you know, upper, you know, arms or biceps or chest or whatever, you know, you see muscular, but core, you know, it doesn't really show up. You can just, it's not a glamour thing. So this type of practice is not a glamour practice. We're not affirming, you know, that we're getting a house to, you know, getting the right house in the right neighborhood. The right house with the right spouse in the right neighborhood with the right kids, with the right car, with the right job, with the right vacations, with the right retirement. You know, that's like going to a gym and pumping iron. Here we're not, you know, it's not glamorous like that. We're getting a whole different world, a world of certitude and safety. You know, safety is a value. We're getting a world that's valuable. That's truly valuable. So that's the prize. We have our eye on the prize, the real prize. Been tough going, hasn't it, the last 3 months? I expected it, you know, prepared for it, you know, in every which way. And I said, you know, I have to power through this, right? And it's been tough. Continues to be difficult. And we don't have to describe what's dawning upon us. We can just say, what I've always wanted to dawn upon me is now dawning upon me. This is it. What I really want is now dawning upon me. Wow. I'm starting to experience it. Just it. Just say it. Or wow is really dawning upon me. The wow. Full blast wow. And yes, it takes patience because again, our bias is putting the brake on it. So I prefer this active sort of meditation to, like this, that it's wow, it's dawning. Using faith in a positive, active way, that it's already here. I'm experiencing it now. Wow, this is amazing. Like that. Rather than trying to make it happen, like I'm trying to quiet my mind down. I'm trying to quiet my mind. I'm trying to get silence. I'm trying to make my mind silent. I prefer to practice in the way that I'm saying is, it's already here. Wow. This is tremendous. Wow. Like that. That's just my preference. I never was attracted to the trying to still the mind approach. I just wasn't attracted to it at all. Okay, well, let's stop at this about an hour and a half, huh? That's great. Managed to get it done. Time to get a little rest now. Let my core rest. I'm gonna feel it tomorrow for sure. And we'll see how it goes. Very great. That's it for this one.